the book of Job, chapter 5 and verse 8. Job chapter 5 and verse 8, Job says, I would seek unto God, and to God would I commit my cause, which doeth great things and unsearchable, marvelous things without number, who giveth rain upon the earth and sendeth waters upon the fields, to set up on high those that be low, and those which mourn shall be exalted to safety. He disappointeth the devices of the crafty, so that their hands cannot perform their enterprise. He taketh the wise in their own craftiness, and the counsel of the froward is carried headlong. They meet with darkness in the daytime, and grope in the noonday as in the night. But he saith unto the poor, he saveth the poor from the sword, and their mouth, and from their mouth, and from the hand of the mighty. So poor have hope, and iniquity stoppeth her mouth. Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness and watch care. Lord, we thank you for those that you brought forward today that they might hear your word once again. Lord, we pray that you'd stir us up, Lord, that we'd be mindful of your word, that we would never get to the point where we thought it was everyday stuff, but rather that it was true and mighty, and the very words that you conveyed to men. Lord, we pray that you would be with the lost that sit among us, Lord, that this day might be the day of salvation. And we pray for the saved, Lord, that we might be drawn closer unto you. We pray these things in the sweet and the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Now, I'll be preaching this morning, the Lord being my helper, of living in hope. Living in hope. And sometimes Baptist people don't want to think about hope, but the Bible is full of hope. Some people think that hope is a lack of confidence. You think, well, maybe it'll work out that way. I would desire that it would work out that way. I hope that it will. But if you read in the book of Genesis, it says of Abraham, I think in Hebrews, that he hoped against hope. When he learned that Sarah would have a child, he hoped against hope. So that shows us two kinds of hopes. One is where we just hope things will work out. And another thing is a God-begotten hope. That goes way beyond our hope. He hoped against hope. You know what? When a lady is 90 and a man is 100, it's not much chance in man's eyes that they'll have a child, but he hoped against hope. In other words, it extended beyond the natural. It extended beyond what we could see and to what God can do. If you ever really get down to salvation, that's what salvation is. It extends beyond what man can do, and into the realm of God, what he can do. And so we see that, and he says in verse 8, I would seek unto God. Now that's my biggest advice to you this morning. And when you preach a message, you mostly have people's attention at the beginning. So I'm telling you why everybody's with me. Seek. You look. You seek out God. And that's not an Armenian thought. That is what the Bible says. Job, and he just finished the misery of his trials. They just had fully finished, and he says, I will seek. You know, none of us has experienced the things that Job experienced. He lost it all. He lost everything, even to the point of the dying of his children. He lost it all. And if you ever watch someone who's lost a child, it changes them forever. I watched my mother in the loss of my sister, and mom has never been the same again. And she is a woman that's full of faith, but yet and still it changed her. You can imagine, amplify that by 10 times. She lost 10 children in one day. And then he says here, I would seek unto God, and unto God would I commit my cause. Now his cause was great. He had lost it all. But this morning, you may not in your own mind perceive you've lost it all, but if you've not been saved, you've lost it all. Commit your cause unto God. And you know what? Really, when everything Word said,
6 feet will even up every one of us, will it not?
That's right.
When you're out here in this lot beside the church building one day, there's no difference between you and me, no difference between the rich and the poor. We're all the same. And so, do we not need to seek God? Do we not need to look for Him? Do we not need to desire His will, and that His will would be greater than our will, that we would desire that more than we do? Commit your cause to Christ. Commit your cause to God. Verse 9, which doeth great things and unsearchable. So he begins to talk of God now, which doeth great things and unsearchable things. You know what? The very fact that he spoke this earth into being is a great and wonderful thing. You know, if you don't believe in literal creation, you need your head examined. How that something could slap into nothing and become something is stupid. You know that? It is just a special kind of stupid. And something just working together to become a living cell that eventually becomes a dinosaur, that's stupid. I mean, it really is. I have a degree in science, and I think it's stupid. How could you possibly come up with something like that? And I won't get on that kind of theory today, but I'll say this, it's based in denying God. That's its real basis. They don't care about creation. They care about uprooting God. They care about demoralizing who He is. And so we see that Job was ready to give God great praise, which doeth great things and unsearchable. Unsearchable means you can't find the end of it. Unsearchable means you really can't weigh it out. You know what? The very fact that I was lost and undone and miserable in my sin, and He did something for me, is an unsearchable, wonderful truth. You can't come to the end of it. You can't see the majesty of it. Me and Adam was talking the other day, and it's just sweeter as time goes by, and you would think you would understand it better, but I think I understand it less because I think I can see God completely in it. Yeah. Nothing whatsoever that I've done. That's an unsearchable God. You will never be able to exhaust the magnitude of the God that we serve. And Job understood that. And if you'll think about it, he's really learning about God. When he places us on these unbelievable circumstances, it's so that we'll know Him better, which doeth great things and unsearchable. Marvelous things are without number. You look around us this morning. Well, maybe 20 people in here. Can you imagine what it took to create each of us in an individual way? People in here from less than a year old to people in their 70s. Can you imagine what it took to bring each of us together? Starting way back in the 1930s and today. And for that appointment He made today for us. That's just unbelievable to me. You know, it really is. But it took an act of God from all the way then to even now to grant us traveling mercies to arrive here this morning. It took the hand of God. And I just can't believe that sometimes. And the power and the deity that belongs to Him. But in fact, Job learned it out of a difficult time. Verse 10, who giveth rain upon the earth and sendeth waters upon the fields, to set up on high those that be low. Now, that is salvation. Everybody says, well, that's someone who's pitiful being elected to an office. No, listen, I was low and low and lower than low when He saved my soul. And He lifted me up to a high position. He put me among the redeemed. He put me in those that are earmarked to be with Him in glory. That's an incredible truth. You know what? That is putting the very low, the muck and the mire, up high above all things. If you're saved this morning, you ought to be able to say amen to that. Because you know what? When you come to the end of yourself,
I mean, you really come to the end of yourself and you realize how putrid you are in the face of a clean, holy God. And He saves your soul. You will be thrilled. I mean, that's a marvelous thing. That's an unbelievable thing that He can move us from a position of filth to a position of holiness just because He can. He set up on high those that be low, and those which mourn may be exalted to safety. Now, one thing you don't have among God's people or anywhere else today is those that mourn. Now, this is a mourning over sin. Because what was He just talking about? He was talking about from being low to being made high. So the subject is sin. And we find here, He says He can move us from that to safety. You know what? If you're living in sin this morning, you are not safe. You're at high risk.
Yeah.
You could be taken out. And God be very just in doing so. That's a danger. You know, the opposite of safety is dangerous. And that's a very dangerous, dangerous place to choose to abide. We need to put our trust in that is a hope. When we're in the misery of despair, there is a hope in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we should cry out to Him. We should look to Him. He set up on high those that be low, and those which mourn shall be exalted or raised up to safety. He disappointed the devices of the crafty. Now He gets into the sinner and those that have an enemy and a hatred against God's people. Now I want you to see concerning Job that the people, there were two things. Number one, nobody could really find much fault with Job. Because God came to Satan and said, "Have you considered my servant Job? There's none like him in all the earth." But then we find these three buddies that come by and criticize, that come by and say, "Man, you deserve this. I knew it was coming." And so in his grief concerning this, he talks about the crafty. You know what? Sinners have no interest in propelling you to glory. If you're lost, or even if you're saved, the sinner wants to bring you down with them. It is their nature. Satan authored that in the Garden of Eden, did he not? He wanted to bring Adam and Eve down to where he abided, down to the lowest of the low. And so he invited them there. And it's still the invitation even today. And so I want you to see that Job understood this. God can protect us from that. It's a disappointment to the evil people when we're successful. It's a disappointment to them. It's a disappointment when one day we stand true to the end and our time has come and we remain faithful unto God. That's a disappointment to the world. The Lord disappoints the world many times by sustaining us. He disappointeth the devices of the crafty so that their hands cannot perform their enterprise. He taketh the wise in their own craftiness. Sin will take you down. You can play with it. You can have fun with it. And it'll take you down. It will bring you low. It will keep you from being successful. He taketh the wise in their own craftiness, and the counsel of the froward is carried headlong. Now, I want you to see there is a counsel of the froward. And counsel goes like this. One time ain't going to hurt you. Just one time. It's only a beer. Don't worry about it. One time ain't gonna hurt you. That's a very crafty way to present it. But when you're 80 years old and you're laying in the nursing home with end-stage liver disease, have they been honest to you? See, a lost person is never really honest.
Now they may be of a fortitude that they're morally stable. But you know what? Someone that will lie to themselves will lie to anyone. And they're lying to themselves. They're lying and saying there is no God. They're lying to themselves and saying, I don't need salvation. They're lying to themselves and says, hell doesn't exist. If God is love, He casts no one there. It's a lie. Every one of those are lies. And they lie to themselves and they lie to others. And we need to certainly be careful and wary of that today. Whose lie are you believing this morning? He taketh the wise in their own craftiness, and the counsel of the froward is carried headlong or downward or falling. Verse 14, they meet with darkness in the daytime, and they grope in the noonday as in the night. Now, they think they've arrived, and they have the answer to everything, but yet and still they're doing like this. They can't get it. They're blind. When God's people are exalted, not because of us, but because of Him. When we have a way, when there's no food anywhere else, and you know what? That happened to Israel. That happened to Egypt, did it not? When there was nothing else, God's people had something. And there the Egyptians were groping around in the dark. You know what? There's something that you can find, but the light has to be turned on first. God's people have always been hated. Don't be surprised. Don't be surprised when they call you narrow-minded. Don't be surprised when they look at you critically, because it's always been that way. And so the Lord reminds Job that this is the nature. He has it under control. Even the enemy is under what he does. Verse 15, but he, meaning God, but he saveth the poor from the sword, and their mouth from the hand of the mighty. So the poor have hope. Why do they have the hope? Because God is on their side. Why do they have hope in the middle of misery? Because God is on their side. Why do we have hope when the world stands and says there is no God? Because we're poor and needy. The poor have hope. The poor have hope. I guess my biggest question for you this morning, do you have hope? Does it extend beyond the grave? Do you have hope? Do you have hope that extends like Job did? He hoped against hope. Yeah, on the fleshly level, I hope I have a son. But he wanted a hope that's based in God. And he knew he didn't have it. What did the New Testament, very, very similar verses of Scripture, when the child was, and this wasn't Jairus' daughter, it was a different event, and the child was dying, and he said, just believe. And he said, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. Yeah. That's the kind of hope. We need help with that. You know what? We should, when we leave out and we go knocking on somebody's door, that hope should abide in us. And we about got down, we're convinced there's nobody left. I ain't going no more. There's nothing to it. We need to abide in hope. So if we're poor and needy, and we are, then hope should abide in us. The hope should be present in us. The hope should live in us and never go away. So the poor have hope, and iniquity stoppeth her mouth. Now you get that? If we abide in hope, those that come in iniquity saying, you're stupid, you don't know what you're talking about, science doesn't back it up, that's foolish, why do you do the things? And the Bible says their mouth would be stopped. They wouldn't have nothing to say. You know what? All they had to say to the Hebrew children was, get out of here. After 10 plagues, they were done. Right? Stop his mouth.
Stop the rebuke. Stop the regard. And so this morning, what sort of hope do you have? What sort of trusting in the person of Christ do you have? What sort do you have? And what troubles in life have brought you down and ended your hope? Now, every one of us would be lying if we haven't had our hope waver at times. Right? Every one of us have had life circumstances that, you know, I'm not sure about this. Right? Now, when we're in that position, let me say this, eyes on Christ. Because when you get in that position, you've looked at the world. If anything about my ministry, I said come out from among them and be separate. But you know what? The world has a very alluring look to it. And when we take our eyes on Christ, we begin to believe that this is, listen, a hopeless situation. This can't be won. There's nothing to do. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Keep your eyes on His ability. And so we see then that there was many, many times that many, many of the apostles lost hope. They lost in their belief in what was able to happen. Go with me in Acts chapter 27. Acts chapter 27, beginning in verse 20. Acts 27, beginning in verse 20. And when neither sun nor stars in many days appeared. Now this is speaking of Paul's shipwreck. They were out there and it was all done. And the reason why it said that there was no stars or sun for several days, that was their only method of guiding where they were at. That was their landmarks. That's how they traveled. And so, in the daytime, there was no sun. And in the nighttime, there was no sun. So they were just whipping and floating about in no direction. And you know what? I believe that's the modern day Christian. Or at least that's where the devil would have the modern day Christian. It just floating about. And, you know, I'm scared. I don't know what's going to be next. I don't know which way to look. I don't know which way to turn. When in reality, we should live in hope. Now I ask you this morning, how many of you are in that situation where you've not seen the stars and you've not seen the sun in many, many days? See, that's a discouraging place to be. And it's hard to have hope in the person of Christ and hope in the person of the great God Jehovah when you've not seen the light for so many days. And when neither sun nor stars in many days appeared, and no small tempest lay on us, all hope that we should be saved was then taken away. So no guidance in a great storm can take your hope, can it not? And listen, we think of those great storms as illness. We think of those great storms as poor government. We take those great storms to be losing your job and financial collapse. But I have found the greatest storm simply to me, simply in my life, is quit hearing from God. Now, did David not have that problem? He cried many times, "Oh Lord God, where are thee? Be not far from me." Did he not? See, that's a storm. That's one of those places that will make you lose hope. That will make you feel like not going on. Not just being broke, not just a poor governmental system, but simply not hearing from God. That will cause you to lose your hope quicker than anything. And every one of us this morning would be lying if we said we've not experienced that at one time or another. Verse 21, but after long abstinence, Paul stood forth in the midst of thee.
Now, if you underline in your Bible, you will underline that long abstinence. Because you know what? Sometimes we just don't hear from God for a long, long time. Now, I will point this out to you. Paul was quiet in his waiting. He didn't say much. He was kind of a big mouth, I think, like me. He usually had a lot to say. But here he was just waiting on the Lord. Long absence. Long time when nothing happened. That's what that means. A long time when you're just by yourself. So after his long absences and seeing really the hopelessness of his companions on the ship, seeing the hopelessness of the situation, but after long absence, Paul stood forth in the midst of them and said, "Sirs, you should have hearkened unto me and not loosed from Crete, and so have gained this harm and loss." Now when we disobey God, when we unhitch from Crete and go where we want to, you've got trouble on the way. If you don't believe me, ask Jonah. See, when seafaring ways, they embark on a mission or a journey. And when we embark on something without the help of God, you're in trouble. Difficulty is going to be coming. You're going to be knocked down. You're going to go through some trials. So he says, you should have listened to me. Verse 22, now I exhort or encourage or cheer you up. Now I exhort you to be of good cheer. For there shall be no loss of any man's life among you, but of the ship. Now, I want you to notice two things. First thing, he was probably the only believer, the only saved person in the ship. So I bet some in that waiting period, he was praying for the ship people. You know what? The hardest thing you'll ever do is pray for somebody that really has no use for you. Praying for somebody that you have aught against. Because that was really when we come to lay down in the portion of the New Testament, the Lord Jesus Christ's teaching concerning tithes. He says, if you lay it before the altar and remember you have aught against your brother, leave it there, go make it right, and then come back and offer it. So in all this quiet time, in all this time of abstinence, I believe Paul was praying because he didn't want nobody to die. You know what? If you're satisfied with somebody else dying, you better pray some more. Now there's going to be people you don't like, but if you would enjoy them to be cast into hell, something's wrong with you. Something's wrong with you. You like love for whatever reason. Listen, you'll get no victory seeing people cast into hell. You're not going to be happy. It's not going to thrill your heart. It shouldn't. Even the thought of somebody going alive into hell. Verse 23, the reason he knew this, and there stood by me this night the angel of God, whose I am and whom I serve. Now, I'm going to point this out, and it's my belief on it, that he was speaking of Christ. Because we don't serve angelic beings. They're there to help us. They're there to be a source of strength and a source of help. But every time that someone went to worship, the father of Samson, he says, see that you don't do it. Don't worship me. And when in the New Testament, he says, see that you do it not. And the reason why is they're just created beings. They're servants unto God just like us. And so I believe that the Lord came to David in this case. Another event, he says, for the Lord has stood by me this night. So he came more than once. That's what made him apostolic. That's what made him an apostle. He saw Christ in flesh. And so he says, wherefore, sirs, be of good cheer, for I believe God that it is, saying, "Fear not, Paul, for thou must be brought before Caesar, and lo, God hath given thee all them that sail with thee. Wherefore, sirs, be of good cheer, for I believe God." Now, you want a remedy for having poor hope? Just believe in God. I believe God. I believe that there is a literal 7-day creation of the place that we now abide. I believe on God's timetable, one day He's going to say, "It's enough, come up here." I believe God is still in the saving business. He still saves sinners. He still creates new life in them. I believe God. And if you believe in God, your hope will grow. If you see God, if you see God's power displayed, you will increase in your faith in God. A lot of people say, "Well, I wonder what's wrong with our churches today. They lack faith and they lack hope. That's what's wrong with our churches." Do you have confidence in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you have confidence that He is able? That's having good hope. So He can deliver us from calamity. He can deliver us from the elements that be. Look with me in Hebrews. Hebrews chapter number 6. Hebrews 6, verse 17. The Bible says, "Wherein God willingly, more abundantly, to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of His counsel, confirmed it by an oath. That by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us." So my question from verse 18 is this: have you fled to Christ? Now, a lot of people want to go through some kind of little silly routine, but I'm not talking about that. I'm asking, have you committed everything who you are and everything within you, have you fled to Christ? Have you gave up on self and fled to Christ? That's the only hope there is. As Paul is writing to the church of Jerusalem, he says, listen, there's no other hope there. And if you know your Bible, you'll know that Peter had dissented somewhat and wanted some of them to be circumcised. He still refused to eat at the table with the Gentile believers. And Paul is warning them, remember your hope. Remember whose confidence. Listen, the work of Christ is completely sufficient. The work of Christ was done when He said it's finished. I've offered the sacrifice. So He said, who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us, which hope we have as an anchor of the soul. That sounds different than what we think of hope, doesn't it? An anchor. An anchor keeps you from moving. An anchor keeps you tied down when the storms get rough. An anchor, something that you can depend on. That's real hope, is it not? Do you have an anchor? You know, this is the thing about an anchor, and you can kind of evaluate yourself. Do you move about? Do you say, "Oh yes, how I love Jesus," and then you trash people? You pick them apart. You say, "This is her problem." Not much of an anchor, is it? No, I want to abide in the will of God, don't you? Put your anchor down. And then when the storm comes, you have a hope that most people don't. And listen, the storm's coming. If you've not experienced it now, you'll experience soon. The storm is a reality that every one of us must experience from time to time. That is simply the situation of this life. And He does it for our good. Which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, which entereth into
that within the veil. So our anchor, the Lord Jesus Christ, is in the veil of the temple. He's even with the Father. That is our anchor. And so I ask you this morning, do you possess the anchor of your soul? Verse 20, whether the forerunner is for us entered, even Jesus made a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Now, Melchizedek had no beginning and no end. He just always was and always will be. He was likened to a type of Christ. He was not in the Levitical tribe, as Jesus was not. And so his order, his office was completely different. It wasn't an office like Aaron fulfilled. It was different. It was more steadfast. You rest in the hope of Christ. That's the sum of the whole matter, is it not? If we live to be 120 years old, does your anchor hold? Do you rest in the person of Christ? And blessed be the name of God, I can say that I rest in the power of Christ. There's nothing I'm going to claim for myself. There's nothing I can say for myself. But I rest in the ability of that steadfast anchor, which is the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Besides that, there is no hope. Besides that, we'd be a people most miserable, as the Bible says. Last place, go with me to the book of Romans. Paul's letter to the church at Rome. Again, as I said many times before, I think they're the church that defected. A lot of people say, well, I don't believe a true church can defect. Well, you haven't seen the churches I've seen. Because yes, ma'am, and yes, sir, they can leave the way, they can depart from the faith, as the Bible says. And I believe this group did too, and I believe that Paul knew that it was on the way. Verse chapter 5 in the first verse, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, you want a measure of salvation? What level is your peace? Do you worry about sleep at night? Do you worry about the soon coming of the person of Christ? Do you have peace? Do you have peace in the time of trouble? Do you have peace when all that is going on in your life? By whom also we have access by faith into His grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Now, I want you to see that true hope will cause you to rejoice. That's what that verse just said, is it not? I don't see a lot of the Lord's people rejoicing much anymore, do you? Sit around and just, woe with me. I'm going to sit down till Christ comes. Well, you know what? You might sit there till you die, too. You might abide there a lot longer than you think you did. Think about, we spoke of Jonah. What did Jonah do after his preaching to Nineveh? The Bible says he went and set himself down. Right? So that's not the abiding place of a true believer. That's not an abiding place of the person, a person of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not in us to sit and be still, but rather that we might be up and about the Father's business. And so we find here that there is a hope that's present there. Now notice what it says, verse 3. And not only so, but we glory and tribulations. Now, typically, what does tribulations cause your hope to do? Let's be honest. It diminishes it, does it not? When we look at the shipwreck of Paul and the mariners, and there was no sun, there was no stars, there was no way to guide them toward shore. When that happened, the Bible says they lost all hope, right? We just read that for your hearing this morning. So our black clouds that hide the stars and hide the sun, and we can't guide the ship in, that is the tribulations that you experience. And mine is different than yours, and yours will be different than mine. But see, the result is the same. We have no guidance. So
But the Bible says here, why? Rejoice in tribulation. Be glad about it. Give God the glory. Give Him praise. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations, also knowing that tribulation worketh patience. Now, the most hard thing you will ever do is learn patience. Anybody ever cooked on a wood stove? You know what the most difficult thing is? It takes longer. Does it not? I don't care how hot you get your fire, it's going to take longer than your electric stove. Right? It makes you be patient. It makes you wait longer. My mother always says, because that's how she grew up, she'd actually left for Nashville before they had electricity in her little home place. And she says, oh, when I came home from Nashville, that food tasted so much better. And you know what? I believe it's because she and that generation learned patience. And you know, if you smell food while it's cooking, man, you're ready for it when it hits the table, aren't you? But what if you had to smell and wait even longer? And that's the case here. You know, you may have to wait a long time in tribulation, a long time in simple hope to develop your patience and patience experience. Now, most of us today have very little experience in depending on God. Now, we have a lot of experience in depending on self. But listen, when there's no way, and we talk about how all those props are jerked out from under us, and we're just relying on self and self alone, that's a very difficult place to be. Developing patience and experience by experience. You know what makes you experience things like this when there's absolutely nothing you can do about it? Not even going and getting a second job helps. There is nothing you can do about it. That's the experiences that Paul was talking about. And when we are out there and we have our anchor down and it's dark and it's stormy, that's what will grow these instances. And patience, experience, and experience, hope. And hope maketh not ashamed. Now, we were living in hope, and the Lord Jesus Christ wasn't real. We'd be ashamed, wouldn't we? So that tells me this, Christ is coming. I rest in the hope of the full work of Christ. What's your hope all about this morning? Where's your hope lying, self? That's a wavery hope. You be careful with that. Do you abide in Christ this morning? My only hope. Fanny Crosby wrote, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus and His righteousness. And that's where mine rests.